Thank you for attending our second Shawnee Speaks event here at the college. It's going to be exciting. Miss Mildred informed us on volunteerism last time. Mr. Smith-Fulia is going to teach us about a life simplified. It's going to be a fantastic experience. So I will quickly introduce him since we didn't do this well last time. So Jessie, Mr. Smith-Fulia, is our sociology instructor here at the college. And does a wonderful job. We've been here for 5 years, right?
That's right.
And time is fun. It's wonderful. So, how many of you have had Mr. Smith-Fulia as your instructor? Wonderful. Wonderful. Several. And for some of you, you haven't had the pleasure just yet. One of these days, I'm sure you will. So, he's going to talk to us today for a few minutes about this. Thank you guys for coming. If you didn't sign up on the sign-up sheet, make sure you take care of that. And we will have time at the end for questions and answers if you guys have any. So thank you guys again very much. I'll turn it over to him.
Very good. Robbie, you okay if I move around?
Mm-hmm.
All right. So thank you all for coming. He said a few minutes. I was thinking like 4 or 5 hours, actually.
Sure.
That's not very simple.
Well, it's not very simplified. All right. If you all could think about and maybe write down, if you felt inclined, about 4 things that you would like your life to be about. And 4 major life activities. So you might say family, or maybe you're a carpenter, so you want to say building houses. But write down like 4 major things that you would like your life to be characterized by. That would be a good segue into this. A new slide. So, I'm going to put you right here if you don't mind. So, because we're on a time constraint, would someone mind sharing with me 3 or 4 things that you wrote down? Thank you, Mr. Brazell. What have you got?
I only got the right one, but I wrote family.
Ah, okay.
I don't know if I did it right.
I might not have literacy.
I have faith, family, learning, and appreciation.
Yeah, that's perfect.
I have gardening and bird watching.
Gardening and bird watching. Wonderful. Other people? Can you shout them out?
Health.
What is it?
Overall well-being.
Yeah.
Health.
Okay. Absolutely. Very good. So, all right. I'm talking about life simplified, or living a simple life today. And I want to tell you a couple stories. But I first want to point out the fact that living simply does not come easy to me at all. Okay? Just to give you an idea of what I'm talking about. When I was in 5th grade, I had a teacher and she asked us, write a perfect day. What would you do in a perfect day, right? And so I'm in 5th grade, so what do I put? Downhill skiing, casinos, and restaurants.
Woo! Right? That's great.
I want, yes.
Casino.
I had never been to a casino, nor had ever downhill skied, right? But I wanted to live this really big, fabulous life, right? So this does not come naturally to me at all. When I was in college, it was a movie that came out when I was about 19 years old that had a really big impact on me. And that movie was Fight Club. If you haven't seen it, I would recommend that you see it. It's full of lots of gory violence and anarchy. But me and my friend, we were really into it. And we really believed that Tyler Durden was our sort of messiah, so to speak, of how life should be lived well, right? And so there was this quote, and in the movie, Tyler Durden is sitting in a bar across from Edward Norton, and Edward Norton has just had his entire life's possessions blown into smithereens. Like, there's a bomb that went off in his apartment. Everything he owns is destroyed, right? And Tyler Durden says to him, listen, the things that you own end up owning you. I know that's cut off there. And that was like the first kind of seed that was kind of planted in my head. The things that you own end up owning you, right? So in the scene, he also says things like, we work jobs that we hate to buy stuff we don't need. Right. So possessions are good. They allow us to do good things in life, but unfortunately, they've begun to rule over us. And I'll get into that in a few minutes. The last story, the thing that really propelled me into this sort of simplified life or minimalism, we went to the zoo when my son was about 1 year old. And the zoo was in St. Louis, and we drove there early in the morning. And they offer a deal where you can buy a canister of soda. It's about the size of that right there, right? And for $8, which sounds like a lot of money. But here's the thing. You can refill it for 75 cents an unlimited number of times, right? And so because I was not a minimalist, I bought it, right? And you can't just drink one or two. You're not getting your money's worth. So I got like six or seven refills. And I don't drink soda, right, like once or twice a month, right? So six or seven of those go down. I have to drive back home from St. Louis, another 3 hours back, and I'm getting a little sleepy on the way home, and so I have another large coffee, right, on the way home. So we get back home, it's like 7 or 8 at night. At this point, I'm gyrating, right? And my wife's exhausted because we just walked around the whole zoo, and she's like, I'm going to bed, and I'm like, okay, I'll join you when I can settle down a little bit, right? So I kind of like meander through the house, and eventually I get on YouTube, right? And I just find the weirdest things on YouTube, and one of them was related to minimalism. There's a video out there, and I actually have a link to it, sort of. The second link there, the third one, the YouTube channel. This woman's amazing. She looks at people who live in alternative ways, specifically different housing styles or gardening styles from what most of us do, right? This video, this guy opens the apartment door, and he got three rooms, and they're almost completely empty. He owns literally 100 things. He owns 2 spoons, 2 forks. He owns a laptop, a guitar with only 5 strings. And the entire place is just, it's empty. But he's talking about how rich and fulfilled his life is. And I'm transfixed by this. And I watched, you know, 5 or 7 more of these videos. And then it's about 3 a.m. my wife's come downstairs, right? I have gigantic garbage bags that I'm filling with blank CDs and clothes and cardboard boxes. And she's like, what are you doing, honey? And I'm like, I'm a minimalist. You've got to change. Everything needs to change. You need to watch these videos, please. And she's like, okay. She goes back to bed, right? So this was my introduction to life simplicity. So define some terms. What is simplicity and intentionality, right? I think it's more about, rather than having it be about just the tiny house, right? Which this house here is like, I don't know, 100 square feet, right? Just, you know, we could fit 3 of them right here in the center area. It's really not about that. Because the problem with just focusing on the tiny house is it becomes about who can get the smallest, right? Or how few possessions can I actually live with? Which means you're back focusing on possessions and the size of your house, which is the opposite, because the house is supposed to be the thing that allows you to do the cool stuff, right? And so rather than focusing on that, it's about questioning and saying, how am I spending my resources, my time, my money, my energy? What am I looking at with my word, or what am I looking at with my eyes? Where are my thoughts going? And trying to say, is this thing just about today? Is it temporary? Is anyone going to care about this song, say, in 3 years, or this conversation that I'm having, and trying to do what is most important? Right? Trying to say, who are my role models? Right? Are they pursuing things that I want the 4 things that you wrote down? Are my role models doing those things? You know, are they a good family person, if you are a family? Are they good at gardening, or they help me with those things? And so it's about intentionality, living intentionally. The person who's not just saying, well, I'm just going to school because I was told to go, or I'm living in this house because that's what I grew up with, and I'm dating this person because that's what I'm supposed to do, and I'm spending my money on these jeans because everyone else wears them. Like, that's the opposite of living intentionally. That's just going with the flow, right? And if the flow is going in a good direction, it's cool, right? But unfortunately, our culture has changed in the last 60 years from being a positive flow to being one that's actually pretty against a lot of the things you wrote down. Anti-family, anti-spirituality, anti-simplicity, you know, very pro-busyness, you know? It's very cool nowadays to say things like, well, I'm so busy. I'm like, oh wow, you must be important. You must be living a good life because your plate is full of all these things, right? Whereas if I were to say, boy, I'm not doing very much lately. I'm living a really simple life. People would be like, well, are you worth paying? What are you doing, you know? We need to have a talk. You should be frazzled and stressed out like the rest of us. Why live a simple life? So, interesting picture of a mother there. Many new moms feel like that basically accurately portrays their life. Doing a million things in a million different directions. Don't you have a saying that you post on your door, Tim, that says something like, if you go two directions, you can't get there, or something like that?
Oh, you can't chase two rabbits.
Can't chase two rabbits.
Yeah, you'll lose one.
Yeah.
Catch them both.
Right, never catch them both. This is kind of the idea. She's going to struggle doing all of these different things, but if she does a few of them, maybe she'll do those few in a better way, right? We live in a land of very, very many options and opportunities, right? There are a million things that will pull your attention, your time, your money away from you. And so we live in a time where the people who are most successful are those who can eliminate as many of those things as they can, right? They hire a maid to clean the house. They hire Amazon to do their shopping for them. They have someone help them with their children. Right? Those are the people who are being most, so they can focus on the other things that they want to be about. Computer, hanging out with friends, I suppose. But that is the thing. We do, and just to stress this a lot, we actually do have a lot more opportunities than previous generations did before us. Through technology, you have the ability to be involved in a million different things. And so your time is really, really being pulled a lot more than it would have been in the past. So I read a book, at least part of a book, earlier this year called The One Thing. Not on the list, but it's kind of an interesting book. Did you read that book?
I did.
Wasn't it good?
It was good.
Yeah. I read like the first half of it. And I liked what he said about how successful people are the ones who are able to eliminate all but that which is really, really important to them. Because as you can imagine, if your life looks like this, then can you really do a great job at any one of those things? No, of course not. You got to get a little bit here and a little bit there and a little bit to this person and a little bit to that person, and you end up living kind of a shallow life, unfortunately. All right, I thought about this. Imagine you want to take your boyfriend, girlfriend, husband, or wife out on a perfect date. Right? And so you go to the restaurant, but before you get there, you've had to work a lot of extra hours because the restaurant's kind of expensive. So when you get there, you're kind of tired. Right? But you want to have this perfect date, so it's worth working the extra hours. Right? And then when you get there and you order, you're like, you know what, I need to leave for a minute and go check on the chef. I need to make sure he sears the pan just a certain way. It's got to be a perfect date, right? So you leave the table, and you go hang out with the chef and make sure that, right? And then you come back, and you sit down, and you're like, you know what? This would be better if the band played a little bit higher tempo of music. So you leave your date, you know, and you go talk to the band, and you're like, hey, you know, let's pick this up a little bit, right? You see where I'm going here. You're doing everything, and you're missing the one thing that's most important that makes a really good date, which is being with that person that you actually want to be with. Okay. All right. So I just created this life map when it comes to things that are simple, just some ways of thinking about different areas of our life. Material goods is probably the most obvious one, but just thinking about how do you think about your life. Material goods is probably the one that gets the most focus. We have an issue with hoarding in the United States. We like hoarding. I mean, we watch shows about it when we're not at work. You know, oh my gosh, that person has so much stuff, right? You know, some houses that are just overwhelmed by stuff, right? So one of the things that a minimalist or someone who's living simply would focus on is consider the true cost of material goods. When we walk into a store and there's this item and it's electronic and it looks pretty cool and it says 99 cents and we're like, oh my gosh, like that's super, super cheap, right? And we're like, I don't really know what that even does and I never knew that I needed it before now, but it's really, really cheap, like really cheap, 99 cents. I mean, right? And so we don't think about other things such as, well, maybe it'll get dirty, right, later on. And maybe it'll break down and I have to fix it. And maybe I'll spend lots of time with it and that'll mean that I don't have the opportunity to do other things that are actually on my list. Right? That's called opportunity cost. If I have to be in London, I can't be in Paris. Right? Not to mention environmental costs. Right? And often the purchase price is actually significant. I'm not doing a great job in all of these areas, so I realize that, but I just had a smartphone. I held out for years, but I got one a couple months ago. And I realized that even though it only cost me $25 for like a Samsung Galaxy whatever, right, which is a really good deal, and that actually is what gets most of us, the good deal. And we don't think about, okay, well, I had to buy a case for it, because half the phones that I see people playing on, they're cracked. They have cracked screens, right? So I don't want that. I don't want that in mind. So I have to buy a case for that, right? And I have to charge it more often than I do my old non-smartphone. So I have to take more time and energy. Where's the cord at? Did I remember? Remember it's going to die here in a few hours. So I'm going to plug it in, right? Mm-hmm. Opportunity costs. I can do a lot more things on my phone than I could my old one, and maybe that's gonna take time away from the things that I would have put on my four things there, right? This is an incredible, according to the LA Times, we have 300,000 things. That's adding up all the forks and knives, not each individually. That's a lot of items. Joella, she helped me move recently, so she realizes that I'm not any better than this. I have a lot of stuff. I was very humbled by that experience. Check out for the children, though. Children, there's about 4% of the planet's children live in the United States, and yet they have 47% of all the toys and books.
Yeah.
My children, that's by the way, they're right there. Why? Because we believe that that books and toys are going to make our kids really smart. And I wouldn't want to get them their 400th book, because then they're not going to be able to get a master's degree in engineering when they're 24. No, really, this is what we believe about. That's why we buy these things. We really buy them, baby Einstein and things like that. Our families are shrinking. Like, we used to have more kids, right? So you would think that by that logic, our houses are getting smaller because there's less of us in our house, right? Opposite is true. Our houses are actually growing. Why are they growing? So we can have our 300,000 things in them, right? But even our 300,000 things won't even fit in our houses, even though our houses are roughly twice the size that they were 60 years ago. So what do? We build storage sheds in the and when they don't fit there, we actually pay a rental storage unit fee so that somebody will just keep our stuff for $60 to $100 a month that we don't have room for in our extra big house or our yards. All right, Joshua Fields Milburn, really neat guy. He's an author. He has a website called TheMinimalists.com. He said, love people and use things.
Yes.
Use things so that they are your tool. When they're no longer useful, say goodbye. Right? They're just a tool, right? And love people. Hang on to them. Use your things so that you do love people. When it comes to fun, right, thinking about what actually makes us fun, this is actually kind of hard, at least for me, to think about what actually is enjoyable, what brings me joy, right? Because we're so focused on work and family stuff and possessions, and often we forget what actually makes us happy. Think about the habits, like what do you enjoy, and then what kind of habits are those building? So one of the things that I enjoy is like watching movies, right? But I wonder, like, what kind of habits am I building? Because they say that your brain actually is more asleep when you're watching TV than it is when you're actually sleeping. So I wonder about that. Am I straining my eyes? Am I hurting my mind? I don't know. Ideally, a fun activity, we would leave and you would feel good. You feel refreshed, ready to face the day. I feel inspired, and I'm smiling. There is a dance group that meets in SEMO, or meets in Cape Girardeau. Occasionally they meet in SEMO, and they do contra dancing. And contra dancing is probably the most uncool dance that you can probably do. It's an old English dance. There's no drums, there's no beat involved. And it's a call dance. People are just, you know, they're saying do this, and everyone does it, and they say do that, and everyone does it. And it's mostly people who are in their 40s and 50s and 60s who are doing it. And so while you kind of feel dorky, everyone in the room is smiling while you're doing it. And so I think about that as something that actually, it brings me joy, but not cool. Not cool at all. Finances. I could talk about finances for a long time here. You can't see it, but this tree actually is made of money. In the original graphic, right? So, money is a good tool. In America, we oftentimes have this expression that money is the root of all evil. It actually is a misquote of Jesus. It says that the love of money is the root of all evil. Money actually is a good tool, but a horrible master, right? Money often bosses us around. When we allow money to make decisions for us, how would it do that? Well, somebody offers you a job making $40,000 a year, and somebody else offers you one making $50,000. If you base your decision on money, you're allowing it to boss you around. And while I understand that money is a necessity, oftentimes we give it more importance than it is worth. Money's emotional. Realize that. That's why couples fight about it so much. And that's why it hits to the core of us, because it is emotional. It's something that represents something that's very important to us. And so because it's emotional, be real about it. And I think just being honest and saying, oh, this is really important to me because money is very important to me. All right, automate when possible. Because of our technology, we have the ability to simplify our finances a lot. And I always harp on my students to start investment accounts, to take money, rather than paying, so for me, I have Progressive car insurance, and so they gave me this option of I can pay the full amount right now for 6 months, or I can pay a monthly installment of $78, but if I'll pay it the whole thing up front, then it only costs me $68 per month, right? And so if I could just take that $68 and put it aside every month, pay myself, and then when the bill comes up, and move that money away, I'll save myself quite a bit of money. And so you have the ability to to pay yourself very, very easily through your bank's websites, start investment accounts where you don't think about it. Everything's automated. There's a book called The Automatic Millionaire. I didn't read it, but I heard an interview about it. He talks about that. Don't work for money. Use money, but work for purpose. Right? Ultimately, if we're just working for money, well, that might work for a little while. After a while, we're going to begin to feel hollow. Because no amount of money in the world is worth your time and energy. Because you've only got a little bit of it. Right? So if I said to you, hey, I'll pay you $200,000 a year to sit right here in this room, you can't bring anything with you, and you just sit there, would you do it? That's the right answer, right? Some people would, right? And they said they're working for money. You know, what if I said you had to do it for the rest of your working career? So you had to sit in this room for 8 hours a day, and you can't just like save a bunch of money and then go work at some other cool job after a few years. You got to do that job for the rest of your working career. Would you do it then? You would get old after a while. So working for purpose. All right, don't spend any money to impress. It was a country singer that I think that talked about how, you know, we work jobs we don't like to buy things for people that we don't, we work jobs we don't like to impress people that we hate. You know, that oftentimes we want people to like us who we don't even know. Like, it's the guy and gal in the hall who I never talk to, but I want them to think that I'm cool because I've got whatever, you know, the cool watch or the cool sunglasses or things like that. So, eliminate debt. Debt is really the opposite of simple living. Debt is saying, I want this now and I will give you my labor in the future. So basically, you're selling your future for the present. And I know you have to do it sometimes for school and for housing, but make those investments. Meaning your school is something that's gonna make you money in the future. Your car, we have a real culture in the United States of buying cars on credit. We'd be much better off if we ended our relationship with that idea. You know, car payments are our enemy. Eliminate debt. And if that means you have to own a car that's 28 years old, you're better off. Because you have freedom then. Because typically what happens is, hey, I get a car payment, and the car payment is usually $400. That's the average car payment in the United States, $400. If you're young, like some of you are, yours is going to be higher, because you're a higher risk to them. Right? So you get a car payment of $400, well now you have to work a certain number of hours. And you don't have the flexibility of saying, you know what, I'm going to take 3 months off and go do something that I really care about. Because that car payment is coming due to you. So, all right. And then the last thing was, Benjamin Franklin said, a dollar saved is a dollar earned. Which basically means that I can go to the movies and spend $10, or I can go to work and make $10. And no, that doesn't make sense. Start over there. I can go to, if I go to the movies and I have to work an extra hour, assuming that I'm spending $10 and I make $10 an hour, or I can stay home and not work and not go to the movies. It's all the same. A dollar saved is a dollar earned. But I actually am going to change this, and I'm going to say that a dollar saved is greater than a dollar earned because the tax man takes part of your $10.
Yes, he does.
Right? So actually, you'd be better off not working and staying home. Because you're going to be richer than you would be otherwise. Right? Consider the value of an activity according to the time it takes you to earn the cost of the activity. If two of us go out for coffee and we go to Starbucks, where they charge like $5 for a cup of coffee, right? And I make $10 an hour, right? Then our activity cost me 1 hour of work. Now, because I care about you, it's worth it, right? But it'd be good to think about that and make that intention and make that decision on purpose. Spirituality, we're built for connection, and so consider that connection, whether that's with your higher power or whether that's with the people, or both probably, in your spiritual community. It's a priority. Again, it's not something like a possession that you can use to get something else. So sometimes I see this thing where people will use spirituality to get possessions. Ugly. Isn't that ugly? You see that? Be vulnerable and honest in spirituality. Spirituality is not doctrine. Doctrine is about the rules, right or wrong. It doesn't actually fulfill our spiritual needs. But being vulnerable and honest in spirituality is. You know, I'm sitting there and I'm praying and I'm like, this is really hard. So I put my cell phone at. I'm late for lunch. Like that's spirituality, right? Telling somebody else the rules. No, maybe not. All right. Work. We spend a lot of hours at work. So I think that just to realize that we spend more hours at work than we do at play with our friends and family. Depending on how much you sleep, maybe more hours than you sleep. Hopefully all of you get 8 hours of sleep. That's what the doctor recommends for us. but realizing that if you may work at a job, especially some, those of you that are young that are working for, you know, low wages, you may feel like, I have a crappy job, I have crappy hours, I have a crappy boss, and the customers who come in, they're also crappy, right? But luckily for you, you're not working for money, right? You're not working for money. You're doing it for a better purpose. So you're deciding, I'm doing this for me. I'm gonna build myself up. I'm gonna learn diligence. I'm gonna learn character. And I'm gonna make it a spiritual practice so that despite all the ugliness around me, I'm gonna be stellar, right? Not working for money. Right? This is tough, this next one. A clear divide between work and non-work. I remember in the day before cell phones, before laptops, and then I remember when laptops first came out and bosses began buying them and giving them to their workers, right? And I'm like, oh my gosh, I got a laptop and it has a DVD player, this is awesome. The problem with it is, now I can work when I'm not at work. Mm-hmm. And my pay doesn't go up.
No.
Right? No. This is a bad deal.
Right.
So the best that you can do is to somehow create some divide between work and non-work. Americans are notorious for not taking vacation days, and when they do, they're working. So you see people on the beach, right? Or a cousin who went to Italy, and what did she do? She brought her laptop and she's working there in the cafe, right? In Italy. She could have stayed home.
Yeah.
And got paid.
Right.
Clear divide between work and not work. Make diligence and attitude more important than outputs and letters behind your name, accolades, awards, things like that. Those will actually end up becoming more important to you in the end than just having more money or more framed pictures. Time. When it comes to resources, really the time is the only limited resource. You could give me $1 million today, right? And I could go out and spend that $1 million today, and then tomorrow I could make it all back up. So money is a renewable resource to me, right? I have it, I use it all, and then I get all more, right? I'll never get this day back. So think about time like that, right? And so if that's true, money for time may not be a good trade. If I'm trading my time just for money, and again, I'm not working on diligence or character or connection or anything else, if it's all about money, that's probably a bad trade. All right, so thinking about where your time goes. I do a lot of like money budgets. Do I do a time budget? I don't. Where does my time go? I don't know. But you can use the same forms that you fill out a regular money budget for, you could do a time budget for. Find out where it goes. So I have a t-shirt idea here, you know, thinking about if you earn $10 an hour and you're buying a $20 t-shirt, you're exchanging two of your work hours for that t-shirt. And of course, if you use credit, it's even more than that. Relationships. This is the last slide, by the way. Treat them as an end, not as a mean. It's very easy for us to compare ourselves to other people when it comes to money, because money is countable. Right? You can't count relationships, right? Well, actually you can. I have Facebook, I don't know if you guys do. I have like 500 friends, you know, I mean, like, right? Pretty cool, right? Not true, because I don't know half of them. People pop up and I'm like, who is this person? I don't know. Maybe they changed their names, they got married, but they're not countable. Money is countable. And so when it comes to relationships, I asked my wife about this, and she talked about, what did she say? That it's about the depth of a relationship, not necessarily the surface of it. Like we focus a lot on acquaintances. You know, I try to be very nice to people. Oh, hi, how are you doing? And a lot of surface stuff. And I know a lot of people who will say things like, I don't have any friends, I only have acquaintances, you know. But it's probably would be worth trading hundreds of our acquaintances for a few friends that go deep. The problem is that's a little bit harder to do. That requires me to be honest and have boundaries with people. And so it's a whole lot easier just to do digital or surface level relationships. realizing that within relationships, healthy relationships, it's about boundaries. I'm not going to try to control you and make you into the image that I want, and I'm also going to ask the same for you. You control you, and I'll control me. And if we can't do that, meaning if we have nothing in common, if I have to manipulate you in order to be friendships, in order to be friends, then it's okay. Let it go. End that relationship. That's all right. In fact, that actually is good. That's a good thing. So, all right. I wanted to wrap this up with some kind of cool saying. I'm not sure I hit it on the head here, but I thought about this. You're born an original, right? Everybody's born a little bit different. We have different tastes and different desires and places that we want to go and people that we want to impact. But oftentimes, we allow other people, society, demands to kind of shape our lives so that we're doing what everyone else is doing, which makes us a mere copy of the culture and not what we want or what we were born to do. So, I had a lot of things there. I went really fast. So, guys have this simple living resource. I like all of those. There are obviously lots of other ones. This is a cool book. Well, me and my wife both read this, Walden on Wheels. It's about a guy who graduates from college with debt and goes to Alaska to live there. He's a fisherman maybe, or does something in the, he works in a park, and he realizes that it's all about the cost of living. He's making like $10 an hour, but he's spending so little money because he's basically in a wasteland. There's no shops. And they're feeding him and they're sheltering him for free. So he's able to pay off his debt really, really quick. And his conclusion was, it's not about your salary, because there's a lot of people in the world who make lots and lots of money, hundreds of thousands of dollars, and they have no savings. They're in debt. Way more than the rest of us even could be able to get in debt, because we don't have that line of credit. And so it's not about how much you make, but about how much you spend. So that's an interesting book, Walden on Wheels. The Minimalist, I mentioned that already. Just to give an extra shout out to The Minimalist. They also are, in my opinion, a good picture of masculinity. I noticed that a lot of the pictures of what it means to be a man in America are distorted, and I don't like the way they're portrayed. These guys, in my opinion, do a good job of saying what it means to be masculine in the United States, even though they don't talk about that at all, but that's my opinion on that. And so, questions? Yes?
The richest man in Babylon, what's that?
Yeah. So, I like personal finance, and it's my personal opinion that when you are broke, you have few options. Right? So if we can understand how to manage our finances, we'll be better, a more powerful position to live simply, to live on purpose. So it is a book that was written about 100 years ago, and it's kind of in parable form. It's set in like ancient Babylon, which according to this guy was very rich, but even though it was out in the middle of the desert, it had no natural resources. But they were really, really good with handling money, and so he shares kind of the secrets of how to get rich. So, I like other books too, but this one's a story. People like stories, and so I like that book. So. Other questions? You all have been an awesome audience.
Can I just ask you one thing?
Absolutely.
You know, I'm an extreme couponist.
Okay.
So you think that's, you know, because some people, my husband said not necessary.
Yeah. Do you enjoy couponing?
Oh, I'm addicted. I really am.
So I would look at it that way. It's something I enjoy doing, and it saves a little bit of money. I was in a dollar store a few months ago, and I was behind a woman, and I don't know how long she'd been there for, but I stood behind her for 20 minutes while she went through coupons, and they scanned things and didn't work, and they scanned something else and that didn't work.
I feel bad with that.
After 20 minutes, the cashier said, you know what, why don't I get you first? So, which means she can still be there as far as I know, you know. But look at it as a recreational activity.
Well, you were saying so much stuff, and I have a lot of stuff. You know, I don't mind sharing.
Well,
you know, because I make gift bags for people's birthdays and stuff like that.
Yeah.
But I have a lot of washer powder, toothpaste. You know, I have a lot of that stuff,
yeah,
you know.
Yeah. So I would just think about, like, what else is it costing you? Meaning, can you have people over to your house for Sunday dinner? Or is the stuff getting in the way of that?
Well, I cook all the time, you know, for people and everything, you know. But, and it is a lot of stuff, you know. Yeah. So I don't know if I should just kind of cut back or, I don't know. Because I do want to build another room onto the house one day and keep adding. I know that sounds bad.
It's not a financial decision. Meaning you're not saving any money. If you're building extra rooms onto your house to store your stuff,
yeah,
it's not a financially... It's something that you just want to do, and so realize that it may cost you $30,000, let's say, to buy stuff. And if you're okay with that...
No, I'm not okay with that, though. So I might have to try to, you know, go a cheaper way of getting another shed put in the back of the house.
But, right, and I'm going to pick on you because you sound like a relative of mine. Okay, I'm going to pick on you.
I'm not a hoarder. I promise you I'm not a hoarder.
You're orienting your life around shopping.
I know. But if you can go in a dollar store and buy $4 of stuff and spend $10, who wouldn't? I mean, come on, anybody who wouldn't do that?
Somebody.
I didn't hear nothing.
I have a whole slide on this, actually. The true cost of stuff isn't just the price that you're paying at the cash register. That what is it crowding out? That toothpaste, that thousandth bottle of shampoo, what is it pushing out that you could fill your life in that maybe you would enjoy more, that would bring more value to your life?
I have an example. Can I share it?
Yeah.
I had someone willing to give me a $5,000 swimming pool. So it's a above ground swimming pool. Give it to me.
Wow.
I have nowhere to put it.
Exactly.
And even though it's an awesome gift, and I would love to accept it, I literally know I don't have anywhere to put it. I would have to actually rent somewhere
to put it. Yeah.
So I looked at her and I said, I love you and thank you for the awesome gift. If you'll hold on to it for like 10 years until I can find a place to put it, that's awesome. But I ultimately had to let it go.
Yeah, but that's a lot of maintenance, though. That's a lot of maintenance.
But it was literally just, I had nowhere, I couldn't literally put it anywhere, so I had
the water bill and then the maintenance to keep it clean.
I would hope that it's $5,000.
Yeah, we'll see.
I know, but the maintenance going to probably be over that much.
Oh, yeah. But it was hard to say no to. Yeah. It was hard.
I got a big backyard now. Where's she at?
I've been
doing it for a long time, and I do have a lot of stuff, and I don't consider just hoarding or nothing like that, and I do share, you know, but I know it's addictive, it really is, because I won't buy anything without a coupon running. I mean, anywhere I go, we got a coupon. I'm looking for a coupon everywhere I go, and I'm addicted. I really am.
And you can coupon to the point to where when you get to the register, they're giving you money back. You're not spending anything.
Yeah, some places don't want to do that. Some places have stopped that, because I was like,
she's the same way.
But okay, let's say I go to the cash register and they give me $100, but it took me 10 hours to gather those coupons. I'm putting a $10 an hour price on my time.
You're right, because I will go in the morning, I won't come back home till 10 o'clock at night. I have been to six to seven stores. But that's what I love to do. Like you said, I enjoy it. It do takes a lot of my time.
There's a cool book called Stuff that I read a couple of years ago. It really helped me understand the thing you're talking about.
I also want to learn how to keep on.
See?
I'm going in the wrong direction.
You mean tell me you would not use a coupon if you had one?
If I had one, I would. But I don't seek them out.
Yeah, I seek them out online. I'm online, magazine, and I'm everywhere, trying to find a coupon, a way to save. But that's part of the trying to stay out of debt, too. You don't think so?
Because if you're building a shed in your backyard, you're putting the extension on your house. That's not safe.
I ain't did it yet. But I'm just saying. But who feels good is going to just grab a bar. while you're ordering, instead of trying to find a way, you know, or a pack of toilet paper, just go get out your...
Yeah. My concern is that you've made the means, the reason, the ways to live a good life, you've made those the ends. Your life is now oriented around the things that were supposed to enable you to have a good life.
Oh, okay.
You know, that's my concern.
Yeah.
And nobody considers, like, no one's a hoarder. I mean, if you ask anybody, no one's a hoarder.
There's some hoarders out there.
But even if you ask them, they're going to say, no, no, because there are people worse than me. Those are the true hoarders.
Yes, I can completely confirm it. Not to get into my life story, but last year about this time, I have a sister who lives in California. She's got a 12-year-old daughter. She literally paid for me and my two kids to drive from here to California so that she wouldn't, one, lose her daughter, two, lose her house due to hoarding. And she owns, well, she pays rent on like three or four different storages just so she doesn't have a mess in her house. And she's got a three-bedroom, lives in one of the bedrooms, and has the other two bedrooms literally wall-to-wall, floor-to-ceiling, packed. Yeah. You can go in the door.
There's just saying it's a game of the world.
So,
yeah.
You might like couponing, but don't let it get a hold of your life.
Yeah, I got a section, just a section, you know, a closet, like a walk-in closet, and I got, you know, I can't, you know, everything's in there in order. Everything's in order. I got my deodorant lined up, all the toothpaste lined up, all the toothbrush lined up. I got everything lined up.
Yeah.
The toilet paper stacked up. You know, I got everything lined, just on the store, you know.
Yeah.
But I do mind having a, you know, having a nice shade in the back to just kind of keep stocking. I wouldn't mind kind of doing that.
Yeah.
I'm being honest.
Yeah. Yeah.
One of the things that is hard for me to part with are things that belong to my children when they were little.
Yeah. I mean, that's the thing, though, that possessions become
like
emotional.
You put meaning on them.
Yeah. Right. And so what like the minimalists would say is, it's the memory, not the thing, that you hold close in your heart. So how can you get rid of the thing but cling to the memory?
Wow, that's volume two.
You take a picture of it. You could share a memory with your kids. And then write a story. You know, I don't know.
Yeah.
Who want to get rid of their little kids, their little graduation gown, their little memory? Who want to get rid of this stuff? I mean, I still got all my stuff, too. I got that, too.
Oh, I can. I've taken trash bags to my kids' room.
It doesn't even bother me.
Because the thing is that those graduation and the, you know, the artwork that they did 15 years ago, it begins crowding us and taking over our everyday life.
Well, I put it all in a tote. You know, I got it all in a tote.
I mean, if you can control it, yeah. I mean, yeah. I don't know what the place for you.
But you know what? But you know, some people think, you know, I ain't no perfectionist. You know, that's why I used to be called by somebody, because I don't like things, you know, out of place.
Okay. Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
So I don't, you know, but I keep everything nice and neat. But I agree with everything you said for stuff.
Yeah.
I don't like a lot of stuff. I won't be able to see one end to the room. I won't be able to see the floors and everything. Yeah. I don't want none of my floors.
Cool. Well, thank you all so much for coming. I appreciate it.
Thank you guys very much for coming. The Minimalists have a documentary on Netflix, by the way, if you're checking it out. It's pretty cool.
Oh, wow.
Tells about their life.